World War II raging on, men from all over the United States were taking up arms to help fight for their country. This left many positions unfilled back at home. Many companies were out workers. This went for sports as well. Many Major League Baseball teams were beginning to fear they wouldn't have enough players to draw in fans and keep the parks open. But while the boys are away, the girls will play.
That all-American pastime, baseball, brings out the All-American Girl Baseball League for spring training at Alexandria, Virginia. Two teams are working out, the Fort Wayne Daisies and the Racine Belles, getting in shape for an opening day doubleheader. Dottie Schroeder is quite confident that her hair won't get in her eyes. And keeping her eye on the ball is catcher Kate Vondreau. Okay, gals, play ball.
When it looked like the future of baseball might really be in danger, Philip K. Wrigley, owner of the Chicago Cubs franchise, decided that it was time for action. He and his men came up with a plan for a women's baseball league. The only real option for women at the time was softball. They decided it was best to keep the ball size and underhand pitching style the same. But to change things up a bit, they increased the size of the infield and incorporated more of the men's baseball rules and equipment. They would also have to track down some players. They sent out scouts looking for the best women in the United States and Canada. Hundreds of women were eager to take part in the new league. Only 280 were invited to the final tryouts, which took place in Chicago. And of those, 60 were chosen to be the members of the first professional league for women. The All-American Girls Professional Baseball League was born. For the first season in 1943, there were to be four teams, each with 15 players, a manager, business manager, and woman chaperone. The teams would be located in four Midwestern cities, Racine and Kenosha, Wisconsin, Rockford, Illinois, and South Bend, Indiana. They started training the girls in the spring of 1943. They were tested on playing their field position, throwing, catching, running, sliding, and hitting. They also had to attend nightly charm classes, where they learned proper etiquette, mannerisms, hygiene, and dress code. They were given a beauty kit and instructions on how to use it. They were all expected to follow through with beauty routines after their games and each morning and night. It told them how to care for their hair, eyes, hands, and pretty much everything else. They were taught how to dress, how to talk, and how to act. As it stated in the beginning of their guide, the girls in our league are rapidly becoming the heroines of youngsters as well as grown-ups all over the world. People want to be able to respect their heroines at all times. The All-American Girls Baseball League is attempting to establish a high standard that will make you proud you are a player in years to come. The girls also had a special uniform to wear on the field. It consisted of a one-piece, short-skirted tunic, a belt, satin shorts, knee-high socks, and a baseball cap. Each city's uniform was a different color, and it had its own patch to decorate the front. Because of their code of conduct, the girls were not allowed to have boyish bobs, wear shorts or slacks in public, drink, or smoke. They were supposed to wear lipstick and appear in feminine attire at all times. They had to have their dates and outings approved by their team's chaperone before they could go out. They also were not allowed to socialize with any members of an opposing team during the season. They were allowed friendly discussions in lobbies, but that was to be the extent of their conversation for the duration of the season.
Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I never get back. Let me root, root, root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame. For it's one, two, three strikes, you're out at the old ball game.
The league lasted for 12 seasons. It went through a few different owners, including Arthur Meyerhoff, under whose management the program reached its peak in 1948. That year, the league had 10 teams, located in Wisconsin, Illinois, Michigan, and Indiana. They brought in 910,000 paying fans in one season. In the years to follow, though, things would begin to decline. People became more interested in other forms of entertainment, and men's major league games had begun being broadcast on television. By 1952, there were only six teams with enough funds to continue. By the last season in 1954, there were only five teams left. It only lasted for 12 years, but the league will always remain a unique part of our country's baseball history. The following was from an interview of Jeannie Lesko, a pitcher for the Grand Rapids Chicks. How did the league influence society? In that time, it gave the local communities a place to go to have a good time, be with people, and forget about the hard times. There was a rationing of food. Many people had to work in factories to make ends meet and replace the men and their families who were off at war. Many worked in defense plants, making instruments of war just to be a part of the fight for freedom for those who were being suppressed. People needed local heroes, like they do today, and we provided them with that. Some of these local heroes still get together at reunions, and they always end with the league's official song.
Battle on, hear that call, the time has come for one and all to play. President who really knows his stuff. We're all for one.